Welcome to the NewsDeck Sunday Guardian Roundtable. Well, today we're going to be discussing the politicization and, of course, the polarization of conversations that are not just on our TV studios, but also the thing we are coloring outside the lines into areas which are non-political, such as a jewelry advertisement or even Bollywood. Suddenly, the anger, the toxicity we see on some of our TV debates seems to be spilling outside on the world around us. Is it just because of social media? Is primetime television to be blamed? And of course, at a time like this, there are some silver linings also. Now we are seeing there are some corporates who are actually coming up and saying, like Rahul Bajaj, like Parle Biscuits, saying that we are not going to promote toxic content. We're not going to advertise stuff that we don't agree with. So at a time when the Tanishq ad is being pulled off, there are others who are talking a different tune. So how do we self-regulate? What are the challenges before us? And why is this happening? To discuss this with me, I'm joined on the panel by Veer Sanghvi, former editor, television personality, author, columnist. Kaveri Bamsai, also former author, columnist and author and commentator. Dilip Cherian, he's an image guru. Shantanu Gupta, he's written a book on Yogi Adityanath and also he's a commentator. Kaveri, we've seen this conversation around us, you know, as I was saying, today is a day when at a time when the Tanishq ad has been pulled off, but we've also seen some positive movement from the other side. What is your take on this? How do you, you know, figure out what is happening around us? Is this toxicity here to stay? Channels say it works, you know, we get our ratings, but now the rating system is also being called into question. So exactly what is happening?
Well, I think it's about time that the industry that says that it regulates itself and talks about governance starts to regulate itself. After all, Bark is a product of the IBF. 60% of Bark is owned by IBF and the other is by ASI and ISA. So it's about time the industry decided that it does something about TRPs. It knows that the system is broken. It's known it for a long time. It's known it from the days of TAM and NTAM when the whole rating system first began in 1998. And it sort of, fiddled with it slightly in 2014, 2015, and it got itself a whole brand new system of ratings and decided that this was perfect. Everyone knew it was not so. It was an open secret. So it was just a matter of time. So I really don't have much sympathy for the broadcasters here. I think it's not a gigantic favor that they've done the world. We know that something needs to be done about advertising revenue. Something needs to be done about advertising, about subscription revenue. And we know that digital is growing, but it's somehow not reflected in the measurements because the measurement itself is skewed towards television ratings and television viewership, which we all know is, especially among the younger demographic, is somewhat declining. So that's one aspect. The other aspect, of course, being the whole unification of Bollywood that we're suddenly seeing, you know, while there was this deep polarization, suddenly everyone from across across the political spectrum seems to have united against one or a couple of channels. That in itself, makes me a little suspicious because there's always safety in numbers, I think. And the fact that while it is good that it has finally shown a spine or the semblance of a spine, the fact that they are seeking security in such a large number, it's more than 50 of them who've joined together, makes me wonder whether they're still so scared. And remember, this comes at a time when Karan Johar and other major producers have also agreed to produce inspiring content for 2022 and have given the government a written undertaking. I mean, I cannot imagine in what other nation would this be construed as freedom of expression, you know? I find this whole system really very, very strange. It's the opposite of, actually, freedom and liberty.
But at least, I don't know, she's saying that maybe there's safety in numbers. But as I said, you know, people are at least beginning to speak up. I think that should be the one step silver lining, isn't it?
While also asking for guarantees, Priya, from the government. Literally asking for a guarantee from the government, promising that they will be good boys and good girls till 2022, if only they're allowed to, if only this monster is taken off their back.
So at least they're saying it's the government control monster. So your take on this, do you see there's a silver lining, or are we going to keep living in fear?
I don't know, Priya. I mean, as far as I can tell, there are two views of looking at it. One is the view most of us adopt, and the view you've taken in this program, which is that the quality of debate in India has become toxic, that there's just so much hatred of social media, and that television in many ways is no more than a reflection of social media. Many anchors are essentially trolls masquerading as TV presenters, and many scripts are essentially WhatsApp forwards. You can take that line and say that the trolls have taken over, or you can take an alternative line, and that's what we are seeing now, which is to say it isn't really so. India hasn't changed that much. Things have not really changed that much. If you look at the trolls who've been going on and on about things like Sushant Singh Rajput, you will find many of these trolls, and I've done this, I've gone on Twitter and looked at them, are new accounts opened a few months ago. Very few of them exist to do anything else other than troll about this issue. The Bombay police, and I'm willing to accept that there are doubts about their credibility, have said that about 70 to 80,000 new accounts have been registered only to tweet and spread misinformation on WhatsApp and Facebook, and that this work has been outsourced to troll farms in Poland, Indonesia, Slovakia, God alone knows where else. It's being done by pros who have glove puppets, who not only send out these hateful messages, also like them. So you create a bubble in which people like you and me say, oh my God, feelings run really deep. This is then taken by various television channels as being the truth, and programs echo the same message. We look at the ratings and we say, oh my God, the point is that those channels are the top. So ones that try and do sensible coverage like yours perhaps don't actually get those kinds of ratings. So maybe India is in the grips of hatred. But what's interesting over the last couple of weeks is all of that has been called into question. This claim about trolls being set up, about bots being set up to make issues work, I think whether it's, regardless of use in Bombay police, I think it's true. There will be an investigation, it will be revealed. This business about ratings, as we've seen, is also true. It's, as Kaveri says, an open secret that you can rig the ratings. It's now, forget again about the police, even Bark, which you cannot say is in any way biased or whatever, which allegedly runs these ratings. So it's not clear that anyone runs them. Bark has suspended those ratings for 3 months, accepting that there's a need for a review. So here's my question. Has it become really a new India full of hatred that you and I come on television and bemoan? Or is this a bubble? Is this manufactured? Is India, yes, different at the margin, certainly, but the basic sense of India, the basic soul of India is unchanged, and we're being fooled by fabricated figures?
I don't know, Dilip, if, these figures are fabricated, but I've also seen a lot of people I know, they turn around and they say, what rubbish are you guys sowing? Can't you go beyond Sushant Singh Rajput? Yet these same guys are up to date with every innuendo, every slander, every, angle, every this thing that on the story. So I feel like maybe by not covering it, I'm doing something wrong. So how do we explain that?
There's fairly a simple explanation for this, Priya. What happens is that in an atmosphere like this, economists say that bad money drives out good. So what is happening is that bad product is driving out the ability to focus on the real issues. And therefore, people are hanging on to all the bad stuff because that is all they are being fed on. So like the obesity epidemic in America, this steady stream of chips and popcorn is going to result in a country which is bloated with opinion, but very short on fact, one. Two, I think that you are talking about all the media channels, almost all of them, except for a few, notable few, succumbing to this game, because the Bark game was the only game in town to play. Owners were only interested in what advertising revenue would come, and Bark was only providing one kind of figure, which is a number which told you that so many people were being entertained by the trolls masquerading as anchors, as we put it, on television. So people began to believe, hey, there is a new show in town and we've got to watch it in some kind of riveted fashion. And they were watching just rubbish. So now the numbers are coming out. Now, whether we like it or not, and whether we, you know, whether, forget the quality of the Bombay police, media may have and media should have an issue with the police having to investigate this. But the fact is that things had come to such a pass that this became, in some senses, a criminal act of connivance. It was not just gaming the system. It was going far more. And fourth, the fourth point is that please remember that in an atmosphere of toxicity, you will not have any growth. As the Tanishq ad, and I'm not going to get into that just now because I'm sure you'll bring it up later, showed, selling of product happens when you create a miasma, as it were, of love, harmony, peace, and etc. That's when prosperity will flow. So if the Bollywood producers and if the government all want us to show a V-shaped kind of recovery, then social harmony will have to become a theme of centrality. If not, if you have hate and divisions, then there'll be fear. And people hoard during a time of fear, and people save during that time because they don't know what's in store. So if you want any kind of an economic recovery, then these fake numbers have to be exposed. The channels who spew hate have to be controlled. And hopefully, like Bajaj and Parle G, more advertisers will recognize that you can't actually sell in an atmosphere of fear because people don't buy there.
Shantanu, do you agree the trolls as anchors? I would even say some trolls go as on panels also. The whole problem with some of the debates are you have these 3-4 faces on every channel, or regardless of what the topic is, you see the same 3-4 faces. Does that need to change?
See, I think I'm not comfortable with this idea that someone who is agree with me, who speaks sophisticated English or maybe Hindi, is a gyani and other one is a troll. I think this is a troll is a very, I think, vague definition. If 17,000 people express their feeling against an advertisement, why they became a troll? So that way, if you are against government, you're also a troll, right? Anyone who's against anything is a troll, right? So I'm not comfortable with that idea. Maybe a usage of language, how you do it, that makes it a troll. But again, a lot of people...
But going to the showroom and also threatening, that's
a legal matter. Police should take care, punish.
Would you condemn it or would you say it's okay?
No. Why will I not condemn, right? And punish that particular showroom guy should approach the police, right? Let's say, let me start the case of Tanishq. No one has touched it. See, what has angered me or anyone or those 70,000 people, trolls as per some of you, is that it was a highly mythical, fictional act, which doesn't happen in the society. What they see is very different in the society. Because in the cases that they have seen, and a simple search will give you every 15 days, there is a case where a Hindu girl married to a Muslim family had to convert, as per law, I'll quote you the law also, Supreme Court, High Court, both. A Kerala High Court verdict told that a Hindu-Muslim marriage is irregular marriage till the time the Hindu bride converts legally to Islam. Otherwise, she can't inherit the property, right? That's a Supreme Court verdict based on the Muslim Sharia law.
Okay, look at the ad itself. Do you think it was a good ad or a bad ad? I mean, do you have problems with the ad itself?
Creatively, it made nicely. Creatively, if you go to the nuances of the ad, so I think she's pregnant, so it must be at least 7-8 months of marriage. So she's saying, oh, aap Hindu ceremony manate, means 7-8 months she has not seen.
If it was less than 7-8 months, you would have had a problem.
I'm assuming, right? As assumption. So she's saying, are aap Hindu tarike se mana rahe, meaning in 7-8 months, she has not seen anything Hindu in that house, right? If I put my, like a spy hat on. Because that is not happening in the society otherwise. Love jihad, a lot of people say it's a bogey. Oman Chandi, V.S. Achyutanand, Christian Catholic Association, Sikh Association in Canada, UK, they've spoken about it. It's not a bogey, oh, Yogi Adityanath has told about it. No. A lot of people very meticulously on the floor of assembly, NIA is searching some of the cases. So it's not a bogey. There are cases after cases where with a fake name, Muslim guys bore a girl, and then they realize, oh, this guy's, I have listed the, if you guys are interested, I can list you the names. I just
you're basically saying that you don't like the ad because it promotes what you say, love jihad. Am I right? Have I got that right?
Maybe that one angle, some of the people see, it's almost like a teaser. I'm teasing you. Something else is happening in the society, but I'll show you something very nice, right? Let me read out. I'm just going through some cases, and a Supreme Court case is quoting Quran 2.221, and it says, and do not marry a polytheist woman until they believe, mean they convert, and a believing slave is better than a polytheistic woman. This is not me saying. Quran saying it, this is part of the Muslim law, which is part of the Indian law.
Okay. So I get,
that's the reality. And you're showing something 180 degree different, so people got riled. That why you're making a mushy ad, which is not the reality. You quote one case here in Shah Rukh Khan's house, that's not the reality. Travel out. My mother is from Rampur. My father was from Muradabad. I've born in those communities, seen this community. That is not the reality. The reality is something else. That's why people got riled.
Okay, so Kaveri Shantanu thinks the ad does not show what he thinks is the reality. Fine, he's entitled to his opinion. But the way, the ad maker has also been hounded so much that he's withdrawn the ad. That is the problem that we're having. Am I right, Kaveri?
Yeah, I think, Shantanu, and I'm afraid a lot of people of his ilk would prefer not to see any of the other on screen. They would like to invisibilize the other completely, if I go by his definition. He would like a society. He claims that society is deeply polarized, and he would like that representation on screen. He would like to see only societies being represented as they are, which he claims is deeply divided, deeply polarized, deeply entrenched in their own customs and traditions. Where will we go as a society if that is the kind of diversity that we show? I mean, we pride ourselves on plurality. We pride ourselves on multiculturalism. And it's not an idle boast. It is a fact that we are a deeply pluralistic society. We stop showing any aspect of this, and a very minor aspect of it, in a state like Kerala, where these things have happened. It is common knowledge that Kerala has at least three major religions. And so far, the BJP, despite its tremendous attempts to capture the mind space in Kerala, has been unable to do it, which shows that there is something clearly very right about that state. So, or left, whichever way you want to look at it. So they would like to show on screen, to show on air, only the kind of reality that they want India to be, the new kind of India that they want. It is not possible. It is not possible to have the kind of unilinear and very, very polarized India on screen, because that is not the only reality. His reality may be true, but then this is also a reality. And that is, in fact, what India is all about. There are many, many competing narratives. He cannot have only one.
You wrote something on the Tanish ad also, where you said it's, people are saying, are they being cowards by withdrawing? But you, if I'm quoting correctly, you said it's, they withdrew, but you also understand why they withdrew, because the nature is such, because people are coming to the showroom, they were being threatened, they were being blackmailed. That itself goes on to talk about the toxicity that we are talking about. Yes, Shantanu can say it's a bad ad, but if somebody else goes, he can say it on a TV channel, but he's not going to go and pick up a brick and go to the showroom. That's where the problem is, isn't it?
Yeah, I think that's true. But equally, let's admit that this is not the first time you've had such examples. In the piece, I think you quote, I gave the example of the satanic verses, where again, because of protests against the satanic verses, the government of India banned the book. When the film Bombay was released, I don't know if you remember it, there were complaints from both Muslim organizations and from the Shiv Sena. The Muslim organizations had their own set of complaints. The Shiv Sena, which I think did vandalize some theatres and threatened to vandalize more, it was believed was acting because this picture of communal harmony that the film conveyed was anti-Hindu. And I remember interviewing Bal Thackeray on record and asking him what his objection to the film was. And I don't know if you've seen the film, but at the end of the film, a Muslim character who's provoked violence and a character clearly based on Bal Thackeray both look around. They see all the devastation and they come together and say, this is terrible. We must never do it again. And that was the bit Bal Thackeray objected to. He said, why should I apologize? I'm not sorry. We will do this again. So look, there are all kinds of people and they have all kinds of views. if they want to troll people, they have a perfect right to troll people. I think the Tatas or anybody else should hold firm when they are trolled. If there is a danger of a boycott, I don't think these dangers are real, not for a jewelry brand. I think they should have held firm. If there is a danger to the life or safety of their people, then yes, they should be concerned. And the point I've made in that piece is one of the problems, one of the things that concern people is that unlike every other Western liberal democracy, when threats like this are made, the police are never around. The police are never guaranteeing you any protection, never saying they'll offer any kind of assistance, because we define free speech in our country as the government will not interfere with your right to say what you like. We don't define it as the government will protect your right to say what you like. And that, I think, is what the Tanishq ad controversy shows us.
Dilip, your take on the Tanishq ad controversy. Do you think the message it sends to down the corporate world, really?
You know, the Tanishq ad saddened me that they withdrew it, because when we created the image of Tanishq at the start, it was meant to be a brand of trust. And we said, you will not go to your friendly neighborhood jeweler or your mother's jeweler. You will go to a new age jeweler guaranteed by the House of Tatas. So trust was central to it. And as I said a little while ago, the idea was that you can sell jewelry if you give people a warm, fuzzy feeling. Shantanu is right in his view, from, say, the perspective of Moradabad or wherever it is, that we are a country where there are lots of examples of violence and of people being killed in interfaith marriages, all of that. But to sell jewelry, you need to sell an idea. It is not teasing or taunting. You are doing a pure marketing activity. The statistics show that to market, you have to sell the concept of happiness and, you know, enjoyment. Why do shops in riot-affected areas scream for months after? Because nobody else goes to that shopping area. Because when you have a scene of violence or of the threat of destruction, buyers take their rupees and go and spend it somewhere else. So that is a basic fact that marketing people are savvy enough to know.
It's only 5 to 10%. So you're saying a major chunk of the spend, actual revenue, doesn't come really from the government or PSUs or state government, but actually come from the corporates. Now the corporates are actually now playing the editorial line. They're going to be telling, or they're going to start telling people what to say. Is that a worrying sign or is that a good sign?
I'm saying that's totally up to the choice. I think some days back we had a Zomato case, and then a very famous line came from the Zomato CEO that food doesn't have the religion, but it's as naive as it can get, right? Food has a religion, right? You know who doesn't eat pork, who doesn't eat cow, what you eat in Easter, what you eat in Diwali, food has a religion. And then you can say something, you can close your eyes and live in naivety, right? And okay, everything is mushy-mushy. And I think Dilip sir already said that we don't show a reality. But now a lot of people who are not even going to buy the Tanishq ad, they're watching that ad. He said, this is not what I'm seeing in the society. Not only in Moradabad, I can quote you cases of Meerut, cases of Delhi. And this is happening. When a Hindu boy, and the Hindu boy slid open, Ankit Saxena.
Moving away from love jihad, let's talk about the fact that people now are going to be objecting to content which they feel is toxic. What happens in a world like that?
See, after 2014, and generally since the social media, now from 5-6 years, social media is up, a lot of people have the information. In another show, I coined a term, who's the Chaudhary of the information. Now there are a lot of Chaudhrys of information. So a lot of people who are established, they don't like this idea. Oh, earlier I was governing everything. My phone call used to make minister, but now everything is set. Right now it's a very different world. My information is not available to me. I cannot set the narrative. I don't set a 9 o'clock line, 9 o'clock prime time. A Twitter trend decides a 9 o'clock timeline, 9 o'clock debate topics. A lot of people are unsettled. I said, this is not the India I was accustomed to, where everything was as per my wishes. So I think this is an adjustment. A lot of people may call it toxicity. I'm saying, if I don't like an ad, okay, maybe I can do a Charlie Hebdo, or otherwise I write on a tweet. And, oh, you'll call me, no, I'm a troll because I don't like that. I'm supposed to like every ad or anything that creatively comes on the field. I and many others express their opinion. And then the people who established, who are now able to set their opinion, now they say, oh, these are trolls because they don't agree with my ad. So I think this will happen. Someone will call it toxicities. I'll call it the difference of opinion. It will settle at some point because the right was praised for far too long. And the Shashi Tharoor kind of person said, oh, right did not have intellectuals. You did not allow them to publish because you controlled publications. And I know
Shashi Tharoor is moving very much towards the right these days. Don't object too much to him.
His books have only Hindu titles. If you read inside, I think they have some other tone. I read all of his books.
Kaveri is going to settle to some level. Do you see that level settling process happening?
I just think we're in so many competing bubbles. There's Shantanu's bubble. There's the bubble that we are supposed to be living in, the so-called Latians, Delhi or whatever. But I want to just bring in numbers into the discussion, some broad numbers. You know, how many Twitter users do we have in India? About 30, 35 million? How many television households do we have in India? 200 million TV households. And of these, if you look at the news channels, they're just about 9% of this entire TV watching universe. So we're talking about, say, about 35 million to 40 million Twitter users, or not all of them are active, influencing 9% of this 200 million television households. I mean, we're talking percentages of percentages. The universes that we're living in and that we're talking about are all so tiny. There's a big world out there, and there are many worlds, there are many narratives. Some may be narratives that Shantanu endorses. Some may be narratives that I endorse. But it doesn't mean that they're not real. They're all real. They're all happening. It's just that we are now increasingly living in these echo chambers of watching a particular news channel, which is perhaps just, and when you look at English news channels, they're, sorry to say, they're just 1% of that entire universe, which is anyway so small. So, and even despite, I was just looking at data recently, Priya, even at the height of COVID, when we didn't have new entertainment, when the Sushant Singh Rajput case was at its height, we had just 21% news viewership of the total universe. So what are we talking about? It's such a tiny fraction. And there's a whole world out there which comprises Tanishq users, which comprises Tanishq buyers. There's a difference between the citizen and the consumer. And increasingly, if we are going to allow, first we had government censorship, then we had corporate censorship. If we're going to increasingly allow Twitter censorship to decide how we take major decisions, then I think we're going to be in big trouble as a nation.
My question to Shantanu, would you be worried if corporates start censoring content that they are going, or is that a good sign?
I'm saying on Kaveri's point, I think... I want to have, like, I'm not a big fan of censorship anyways, right? I think I criticize a book, I'll write a book to criticize that, right? So I'm saying, but versus a government censorship and corporate censorship, I will go for a Twitter censorship because that is far more democratic. Because the government will have a particular ideology.
I have censorship at all, Shantanu.
But yeah, censorship
is supposed to be a democracy.
See something. Twitter censorship is not even a censorship, just an expression of view. And now you take it or not take it. Tanishq was allowed to not. Zomato did not. Zomato said, okay, food does not have a color and whatnot, right? So they might have taken the repercussion in the sales, we don't know, or might not, or maybe the moment have passed, right? So I think it's corporate to decide. But yeah, I think these ideas has emerged. As soon as the new ideas are coming, I think someone will call it toxic. I'll say it's the synthesization of ideas. Clash of civilization is happening in India from 1,000 years. Now it's become more vocal. The other side is also very articulate. They're also getting published in English. They're also going to Khan Market and signing their books. And that's uncomfortable for a lot of people. And
you're still, Shantanu, you're still the other side. You're in power. Wake up. It's been 6 years.
So power and intellectual power is very different, Kaveri. Power and intellectual power, even you go to, I'll tell you.
All right, I'm going to end now, Shantanu. You're totally out of time. I want to give Veer the last word on the censorship issue.
Go to Jaipur Literature Festival and just see the author's list, and then you'll identify the intellectual power is still with the left.
Okay. Okay, this is not that Latians versus...
Sorry.
So just to take off from what Kaveri said, Priya, is that we often don't realize how small the numbers are.
Yes.
Kaveri said that the English television audience is 1% of the television universe. In fact, it's less than even 1%.
Exactly.
So to manipulate that kind of audience is the easiest thing in the world. To manipulate Twitter, to manipulate Facebook, to manipulate WhatsApp is the easiest thing in the world. So if you have money, and many sides have money, I don't want to get into whose side is which. If you have money and you have the expertise, you can manipulate anything. You can create bubbles, you can create a rising new elite, which is fighting the old elite. You can create this all in your mind. You can translate it into this tiny bubble. And then you can say, this is the victory of a new elite, and that is why the old elite is upset. Maybe it is. But the point is, the evidence still isn't there. It comes from a very small petri dish, and a petri dish which is contaminated.
So on that note, I think we're totally out of time. So yes, there was a regime change. There was, a change on the way, whether it was the media, whether it was social media. But also, I think I agree with Shantanu, there is a level finding process that is going on. Whether this is just a small group of influencers or a larger lot will have their say, something we'll see. But at least a conversation is taking place around this. So let's see at what level the toxicity finally settles, or does it go out of the window. But that's it for now. Thank you for watching this show, and we'll see you again same time next week.
For more such videos, subscribe to the NewsX YouTube channel, hit the bell icon.